Sorry, just for a moment. have you ever seen a watch?
Yes.
Oh. Does it have parts?
It has lots of parts.
Oh. Well, if you have all the parts in your hand, separately. Do you have all the parts?
Yes.
Ah.
No?
Hey, if the parts are stuffed in the watch, do you have the whole watch? You know, just stuff them in.
I think so.
Oh.
Unless you're counting the box. The box isn't part of the watch.
Like, do you have a watch? I can take all the parts and then just stuff them in the case. And it'll still be a watch, won't it?
No.
No!
Yeah, it'd be a broken watch.
What? Hey. If the parts, if they must be arranged according to some plan, that brings the parts together, would you call that the unity of the parts? If someone gave you all the parts for a watch, could you put them together without knowing how the plan of how they all fit?
I couldn't.
Oh. So then we need a new name for when they all come together according to a plan. Right? Would you call that the unity of the parts?
To have a plan to put it together?
Well, is it once you have that unity of the parts, they all function together, don't they?
Yes.
Yeah. Is there a difference then between whole and unity? Because if I have all the parts in my hand, I have all of it together, don't I?
No.
I have.
No.
But I. No? I just have parts.
You just have parts.
But I have all of the parts.
But they're not working parts. It has to be working as a unit.
Oh!
It has to be functional.
Oh, wait a minute, that's a higher point you're raising. Like, look here, see? If the parts are stuffed into a watch, would you say you have the whole watch? Or must they be in a certain way?
They has to be in a certain way.
Ah. So there's something more to the word whole than the sum of its parts. Is that right?
Yes.
Oh. And then if they fit according to some plan, you want to use another word other than whole then, don't you? What would you say? No, ask him.
Maybe Ingmar knows.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
ask him again.
Oh, if you have all the pieces of watch together, would it be considered whole? Is that the question?
Some people think that a whole is the sum of its parts. Agree? So
yes.
That,
yes.
That if I have all the parts, right, I have them all, what do you want to call it? I have all of the sum of all the parts, I got them all. Do you want to call that whole or just all? I have all the parts.
It seems like it's a whole.
Well, then you have the whole wash, even if you've got it all in your hand, here. Here's your watch back.
No,
is that right?
Doesn't sound right. I don't think so.
What?
It's not.
No. Okay. So you do.
So it's not.
That's not a watch yet.
Right.
Oh. So the sum of all its parts means, we're saying, that means you have all the parts. Not yet the whole. Right? Ah, so wait a minute. Is that true?
Yes.
Oh, wait a while. Would you go for that? We say the whole must follow some plan. Get putting all the parts together. And not just be together in any old way. Must it be a special way? Is that right? Would you say that?
Right, that's right.
You see, people are very foolish. See? Because if I only had an expensive watch to use as an example, do you have one I can take apart? No, see, because...
I had one last week, do you remember?
Right? You can put all the parts in a bag and shake them up. You know how many different arrangements you would have? They'd all be different, wouldn't it? So when you're talking about the arrangement of the parts, it has to be in some special way, doesn't it?
Yes.
Not just together in some random way. Ah. Well, if so, then, what are you going to call it? Is that the use of the word unity?
Yes.
Well, then we have all, we have a whole, and now we have a unity, don't we? Three terms. Would you agree? Not every whole has a particular plan where all the parts must be together. So there's a difference between a whole that has all its parts together in some unity versus all the parts just arranged in a haphazard way. Good? Oh, so whole and unity is different from just saying you have all the parts. Oh. Well, would it follow that this is a higher order? But we need another thing, see? It's still not worth a damn unless it matches some standard that is not usable. As an object that can determine the time of day or any other standard. Agree? So now, wait a minute. Does that mean now we have a higher? Once you talk about function, must we not?
Yes. What is that word? Some standard, it is not what?
But unless it matches some standard.
Thank you.
So now, look here, we need another term that now can function, come on, it can now function as a timepiece, right? Now it's a higher level. Now, what name do you want to give that? A functioning unity. Agree? Would you agree?
Yeah. Yes.
Oh. Well, I just want to do this to waste some time. But anyhow, let's take a look at our master, the sophist. We're on page 245B.
Can I flip this back?
Sure.
If you don't need it.
Well, just take like a couple of paragraphs. Okay.
Well, on that last page, not that one, it seems that that one and two, I don't see any great difference there. If you flip that up.
Yeah, I cleaned it up.
Where it says all the parts and unity, one is just like a bag of pieces of a watch, and then number two is they're together and it doesn't work, and then number three is it works. Is that correct?
Well, you can, yeah. And especially a pure one, therefore, has no parts, therefore it's not a whole, right? It's not a whole, it's not a unity. Is that right? Just thought I'd ask.
It's a weird one.
It is a very weird one. Okay.
Could you just say what that last part means? Pure one has no parts.
Pardon?
Pure one has no parts.
Yeah.
Could you just say what that means?
No, that's what it means.
I don't get it.
That's what the word pure one means. It has no parts.
That just means the knowledge to make the thing work. Is that what you mean?
Well, if it did have parts, it would be a many, wouldn't it?
What
would you agree?
Well, this is a watch, right? Like.
Yeah, forget the watch. Would you agree? I mean, if it had parts, would it still be a one, or would it be many? Both? It's going to be both one and many?
Yeah, wouldn't it? No?
Yeah, so in this curious game, the highest state of mind is a pure one. No parts. No parts. Of course, if it did have parts, it wouldn't be one, it'd be many, you know. Anyhow, want to try this? 245, want to read? Okay, B. Why, surely that which is really one must, according to right reason, be affirmed to be absolutely without parts. Agree?
Yes, it must. 245B.
Yes. Right? Okay. Robert?
Well, I thought Ingmar volunteered. I didn't want to cut him off.
Yes, it must.
Okay. I did. I said, yes, it must. I did.
But such a unity consisting of many parts will not harmonize with reason.
I understand.
Then shall we agree that being...
What did he just do? He went from one to calling it unity in this translation. Agree?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well. But go ahead, we'll ignore that minor point.
Then shall we agree that being is one and a whole because it has the attribute of unity? Or shall we deny that being is a whole at all?
What do you think of that in terms of what we've been doing?
Parmenides.
Look, see.
Second hypothesis.
This is an example of reasoning of a certain kind. Did he skip a few steps?
Yes. Hmm. He did. Yes, he did.
Well, look here.
Not only that, he seems to be mixing levels of unity.
Now, being is one first step, right?
Mm-hmm.
And a whole.
After he just said,
depending upon how you identify what a whole is.
Yeah.
Because if it's got parts, then it's many.
Yep.
Right? Because it has the attribute of unity. Wait a minute. Does the one have the attribute of unity?
No, not the pure one.
Not the pure one, because it would have to have parts in a certain relationship.
Yep.
Or shall we deny that being is a whole at all? By the way, he hasn't reasoned to tell us what kinds of thinking allow that statement to be made.
Yes.
Right?
It is a hard choice you offer me.
But yeah. What should Aristoteles have said?
Let me hear the reasoning.
Where's your reasoning?
Yeah.
Right. You call this reasoning? Okay, okay.
That is very true. For being, having in a way had unity imposed upon it, will evidently not be the same as unity, and the all will be more than one.
Yes.
Wait a minute. If it's more than one, can that be reconciled with his opening statement? That it's absolutely without parts?
No, can't be reconciled.
Now it's more than one.
Now it's more than
but one. It's the all he's talking
okay,
about.
Okay, watch the next step now.
And further, if being is not a whole through having had the attribute of unity imposed upon it, and the absolute whole exists, then it turns out that being lacks something of being.
Okay, now, why don't you just stay with that remarkable paragraph? Can you reconcile that with the previous statement?
No.
No. But ignore that minor point.
Certainly.
And so by this reasoning, since being is deprived of being, it will be not being.
So it will.
Where is the reasoning that precedes to that conclusion? Right? Does it need some? Now look at it. Since being is deprived of being, there will be not being. Right? First statement he made that sounds good. Right? Look at it. By the way, is being deprived of being?
No, he's building that he thinks he's building that on being lacks something of being, right?
Yeah.
But that isn't the same as saying that being is deprived of being.
Yeah. It's foolish to say being is deprived of being.
Hmm?
It's foolish to say being is deprived of being.
I think so. When you're talking about a portion, even on the...
And again, go ahead.
And again, the all becomes more than the one, since being and the whole have acquired each its own nature.
Well,
I don't get it, stranger.
These are these connected statements? The all becomes more than one. It doesn't become more than all than one. It is more than one. It's not becoming.
No surprise there.
No surprise, right? But the reasoning, since being and the whole have acquired each its own nature. If each have their own nature, and we're talking about the one, that means it has parts, and the parts are a being and the whole. Does that fit his original statement? No. These are minor points. Right. Go ahead.
Unless he means the absolute whole.
But if the whole
does not exist at all, being is involved in the same difficulties as before.
We didn't see the difficulties before, but go ahead.
And besides not existing, it could not even have ever come into existence.
What do you mean?
That which comes into existence always comes into existence as a whole. Therefore, no one who does not reckon the whole among things that are can speak of existence or generation as being.
That certainly seems to be true.
So, let me go back, okay? If the whole does not exist at all, being is involved in the same difficulties as before. Why? Is there any connection between those two great statements? Does he need it?
Yes, he needs it.
Desperately?
Yeah. 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 From what he's.
Now, besides not existing, it could not even have ever come into existence. See, look here. Are these interesting remarks that have no unity?
Yes.
They can all be said, given a certain context and exploration. They're all conclusions, but they don't fit together. Well, let's just ignore that minor point. What do you mean?
That which comes into existence always comes into existence as a whole. Therefore, no one who does not reckon the whole among things that are can speak of existence or generation as being.
What do you think of that? See, it's true and it's false. It depends upon how you understand the word whole. Mm-hmm. Like, have you ever seen kids?
Kids?
Kids, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
There's a little. Oh. Do they come out of the womb whole?
Well,
usually? With
yeah,
luck?
Well, they look like they're complete.
Yeah. By the way, do they undergo changes?
Yes.
Oh. Does the kid therefore add certain things and qualities that they didn't have at birth?
As they grow.
Yeah, as they grow.
Yes. Yes.
Well, then there's a different kind of whole at birth and 10 years later.
Yeah.
Is that covered in this argument? That which comes into existence always comes into existence as a whole. Therefore, no one who does not reckon the whole among things that are can speak of existence or generation as being. Wait a minute, did he just shift into a new, now he's talking about being, is that right? Look here. Let's do this.
I don't know if you're.
It's very easy to understand.
Yeah.
Now, look here. Things that come into existence, right? This is called appearances. Or becoming. Okay? By the way, the word being always is and stays the same. Therefore, these are two different realms. Let's go back into the quote. That which comes into existence always comes to existence as a whole. Therefore, no one who does not reckon the whole thing among things that are can speak of the existence or generation of being. Hey, being ain't generated. He's switching terms. He's saying, because that which comes to existence can be said to be is, now he talks about it with the word being. That's switching terms. It doesn't follow. Moreover, that which is not a whole cannot have any quantity at all. And that assumes that it's talking about wholes that have parts. Therefore, that which is not a whole cannot have any quantity at all. By the way, isn't that true? Like, if you take the parts of a car, they're not numerable, are they?
They're not numerable?
Yeah, you can't count them, can you? No, you can't.
Why not?
Yeah, because if this is true, that which is not a whole cannot have any quantity at all. Do you agree?
Not now, I don't.
Oh. Right? For if it has any quantity, whatever that quantity may be, it must most necessarily be of that quantity as a whole. Right? Is that always true? Like any part of the of those parts is the same thing as the whole, isn't it? Then you only have to take a couple of parts of the parts of the car, you can forget about the other, can't you?
No.
Yes. No? Oh, that's rather curious. Precisely.
And so countless other problems, each one involving infinite difficulties, will confront him who says that being is, whether it be two or only one.
Has he pointed out the difficulties, the countless difficulties and problems? If someone says being is, whether it's two or one?
I don't know.
Let's ask, is being, look here, thank you. Is being is being one or two? It could be either one, right? But is there infinite difficulties involved in assuming being is one or two? Where has he mentioned them?
Not infinite.
Not yet.
I think you'd have to talk a lot more.
Yeah. Now watch his great conclusion. Here's a summary. Ready? Go. The problems now in sight.
Theaetetus.
That's obvious. The problems now in sight make that pretty clear. For each leads up to another, which brings greater and more grievous wandering in connection with whatever has previously been said.
Well, now we have not...
Hey, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. What do you think of that? The problem's now in sight. Has he given the problems in that previous statement?
No.
No? But keep those problems clear in sight.
Mm-hmm.
Has he even mentioned them?
No.
But you're required to do what?
Keep
them in, yeah, keep them in, clear in your mind, even though he hasn't stated them. Right, it's a lovely piece of work, right? Stranger, yeah?
Now, we have not discussed all those who treat accurately of being and not being.
That's true.
Oh my God.
We finally hit it. This is now true.
However, let this suffice. But we must turn on our eyes.
He's already talked all about being and non-being, has he? Has he?
No.
But let this suffice. That's enough.
Zero is enough.
Yeah, zero is enough. Go ahead.
He's not going to actually talk about the guys who do it accurately. He's just going to let his own suffice.
Is that the one?
So now he's got a great solution. Okay, Barbara? Go ahead.
But we must...
Oh, go ahead.
But we must turn our eyes to those whose doctrines are less precise.
What? No, more precise. You got the wrong quote.
No, it says less.
Less? I mean, he's a wise person to follow, right? Go after a less accurate quote. Yeah, go ahead.
That we may know from all sources that it is no easier to define the nature of being than that of not being.
Yeah, and the way you can do that is you go to material that is less accurate. Is that right?
Yes, it's what he's saying.
Yeah, we'll turn to those doctrines that are less precise. Right, that is certainly a good way to define the nature of being and non-being. Is it?
No.
Don't tell me.
No, not especially.
How's he doing?
Not good.
Yeah, well, he cleans it up now. Watch.
Very well, then. You must proceed towards those others also.
And indeed, there seems to be a battle like that of the gods and the giants going on among them because of their disagreement about Usia.
Wow.
Now, this is remarkable, right? We all have been on the Usia being the property that allows one to turn upon oneself and discover the nature or the true nature of man and other soul, self, etc. Okay, there's going to be a battle because of the disagreement about Usia.
Mm-hmm.
Has he discussed it yet?
No.
No. But we'll get it now. Right? What are we going to get? The great battle between the giants. Right? Go ahead.
How so?
Some of them drag down everything from heaven and the invisible to earth, actually grasping rocks and trees with their hands. For they lay their hands on all such things, and maintain stoutly that that alone exists which can be touched and handled. For they define existence and body, or matter, as identical. And if anyone says that anything else which has no body, exists, they despise him utterly, and will not listen to any other theory than their own.
Terrible men they are.
What is that statement? Come on. Do they drag down everything from heaven and the invisible to earth? Right?
No.
What set of ideas would that be?
It should be being and other.
There'll be clearly things they put their hands on. And maintain stoutly that that alone exists, which can be handled and touched, right? Are those the heavenly notions?
No.
See, the heavenly notions are the major ideas dealing with the metaphysics, ontology, being, etc.
Yeah.
Who see it? By the way, Did he use the word Usia so far in this explanation of the Great War? No.
He uses it in the same translation, existence and body.
Yeah, it's a Usian, right?
Yeah.
But is he using it in that way?
No, he's not using it as we understand it.
So the thing he needs to explain, he's using in what way? In a popular. Unsophisticated way.
Yeah.
Okay, go on.
Worse than that. Terrible men they are when you speak. I myself have met with many of them.
Therefore, those who contend against them defend themselves very cautiously with weapons derived from the invisible world above, maintaining forcibly that real existence consists of certain ideas which are only conceived by the mind and have no body, but the bodies of their opponents and that which is called by them truth, they break up into small fragments in their arguments, calling them not Usia, but a kind of generation combined with motion.
That's right. By the way, focus on the sentence. However, this is the way I think we must deal with them. What is the way we must deal with them? Yes.
Okay.
Go ahead.
The paragraph begins, it is comparatively easy.
Our first duty?
Our first duty would be to make them, that's it, 246D5. Mm-hmm. Our first duty would be to make them really better if it were in any way possible. But if this cannot be done, let us pretend that they are better by assuming that they would be willing to answer more in accordance with the rules of dialectic than they actually are. For the acknowledgement of anything by better men is more valid than if made by worse men. But it's not these men that we care about. We merely seek the truth. Quite right. Now tell
them. Our first duty will be to make them really better. Right, therefore, we're going to be engaged in some good teaching.
Yeah.
Right? If that were possible. Wait a minute. If that were possible, it may not be possible? Well, forget that. But if this cannot be done, that is, we can't make them any better.
It's become now impossible.
Let us pretend they're better. What are being asked to do?
Pretend.
Make believe. Well, make believe they're better and go on with the discussion.
Yep. No good. Especially because of his next statement.
So we're going to make believe they're better because, after all, it may not be possible to make them better. So we'll just go ahead and make believe. Right?
Yes.
And we'll assume they'll be willing to answer in accordance with the rules of dialectic. What kind of people are they? Those that we're going to pretend that they are better.
Right. But it says, the acknowledgement of anything by better men is more valid than made by worse men, but the worse men are the guys we have here. We're only pretending they're better.
Are you ready for the next one?
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead.
Now tell them, assuming that they have become better, to answer you. And do you interpret what they say?
I will do so.
By the way, if they have become better in answering you, you wouldn't need to interpret them. But let that minor point go by. Go ahead.
Oh, you're right.
Let's see if he does so.
Let them tell whether they say there is such a thing as a mortal animal.
Yeah, this is the way to go. This is called the dialectic.
Of course they do.
And they agree that this is a body with a soul in it. Do they not?
Certainly.
By the way, where's the argument that this body has a soul?
No argument.
Oh, let's skip that. Okay, go ahead.
Certainly.
Giving to soul a place among things which exist.
Has he demonstrated that soul exists? No.
And he's actually giving it a place among
these are just minor points.
Yes.
Well then, do they not say that one soul is just and another unjust, one wise and another foolish?
Of course.
And do they not say that each soul becomes just by the possession and presence of justice, and the opposite, by the possession and presence of the opposite?
No, because it's obvious that you can possess justice. Right? And if you possess it, then it's not going to be for anyone else. Would it be? I ignore that. That's just a minor point.
Yes, they agree to this also.
But surely they will say that that which is capable of becoming present or absent exists.
Yes, they say that.
Granting then that justice and wisdom and virtue in general and their opposites exist, and also, of course, the soul in which they become present, do they say that any of these is visible and tangible, or that they are all invisible?
That none of them is visible, or pretty nearly.
By the way, has he demonstrated that set of ideas, there's also a set of opposites that also exist? No, but it's a minor point. Right? Okay, go ahead.
Now, here are some other questions. Do they say they possess any body?
They no longer answer the whole of that question in the same way. They say they believe the soul itself has a sort of body. But as to wisdom and the other several qualities about which you ask, they have not the face either to confess they have no existence or to assert that they are all bodies.
It is clear, Theaetetus, that our men have grown better, for the aboriginal sons of the dragon's teeth among them would not shrink from any such utterance. They would maintain that nothing which they cannot squeeze with their hands has any existence at all.
Therefore, all of those ideas do not exist. Go ahead.
That is pretty nearly what they believe.
Then let us question them further, for if they are willing to admit that any existence, no matter how small, is incorporeal, that is enough. They will then have to tell what that is which is inherent in the incorporeal and the corporeal alike, and which they have in mind when they say that both exist. Perhaps they would be at a loss for an answer. And if they are in that condition, consider whether they might not accept the suggestion if we offered it, and might not agree that the nature of being is as follows.
What is it? Speak, and we shall soon know.
Well, I suggest that everything which possesses any power of any kind, either to produce a change in anything of any nature or to be affected even in the least degree by the slightest cause, though it be only on one occasion, has real existence. For I set up as a definition which defines being that it is nothing else than power.
By the way, is that a definition of being?
No.
Sir, is that a definition of being?
No.
Thank you.
Why is it not a definition of being? Why does that not suffice as a definition of being?
Because anything which possesses any power of any kind to produce a change, right? Even in the least degree, right? That's the definition that defines being, and it's nothing other than power. The question is he talking about this realm or this realm? Good, let's do it. Everything, talking about things, which possesses any power of any kind. Give me something which possesses some kind of power. How about a bed bug?
Yeah.
Huh?
Okay.
Okay, right. If it possesses any kind of power, even the least, right? It has real existence, and he defines that, right? He says, that defines being. A bed bug that has power is defined as being.
No, I don't see him saying that. I don't see him saying something that has being, and therefore has power. It is being. No, I see him just saying that being is power.
No, see, he's saying being, and this is the word being, ontos, right? He sets up the definition which defines being as power. And it's in everything. Everything which possesses any power, no matter how little, even if it's only on one occasion. Is that being?
Well, wait, okay, so when I originally asked the question, let me clarify, my intent is he could be correct or incorrect in his definition, but it still suffices as a definition that he's working from, right? But you're saying no.
No.
Or are you saying that for it to suffice,
well,
to be true?
Strictly speaking, he's defining being as belonging to this class. It produces change, becoming. And in all philosophy, being is not there. It can be considered in certain aspects power, but the argument for that is not present. He's talking about things that have the least little possibility of changing something.
Why does that not suffice as a definition, though? It could be
totally wrong and stupid.
No. It does it does define it. Where does it put it? And what we've been building are up here.
I'm not actually sure where it puts it. What he's saying is that it has the power to cause a change so that it has an effect on the upper class. But whether it itself is a member of that upper class, I don't see him saying it. But he is saying it's essentially synonymous with power, the eagle's power. That is a definition, is it not?
The only question is,
you didn't answer.
If you want to position it, where would this statement belong given that paragraph?
Given those two classes?
No. Because becoming needs a power.
Yes.
So does change.
And change.
Changing to an other.
He can define it any way he wants. We have to position it where it belongs.
Well, I would at least as I look at it, I cannot position it then because it's not clear from what you're saying.
Before he talked about one, did he not, has no parts? Right. Does it look like we're still talking about that kind of thing? Because if it has power, that's a part. So I'll tell you what we can do. We can put it like this. Where does it belong? Right? There's a grounds for putting it here. There's grounds for putting it here. Third possibility. He's defining it in such a way that you have to decide where it belongs. Just a couple of more. Watch, okay?
Since they have at the moment nothing better of their own to offer, they accept this.
Hey, isn't that a great line? Right?
Yeah, he doesn't seem to like that last line either.
Okay, good. Go ahead.
Good. For perhaps later, something else may occur both to them and to us. As between them and us, then, let us assume that this is for the present agreed upon and settled.
So, isn't that a good way to settle the issue we have here? Right, we just settled it.
Yeah, we assume it's settled. Yeah.
Haven't we?
Yeah, we might change our minds later, but.
And that will do for us. Watch now the shift. Now we should be here. Let's go there. Go ahead.
Then let us go to the others, the friends of ideas. And do you interpret for us their doctrines also?
I will.
You distinguish in your speech between generation and usia, do you not?
Yes, we do.
And you say that with the body, by means of perception, we participate in generation, and with the soul, by means of thought, we participate in real being, usia, which last is always unchanged and the same, whereas generation is different at different times.
Okay, that's a philosophical statement. It shows he understands the difference between these two realms.
Yes, that is what we said.
So no doubt about the fact that he does understand these distinctions.
Yes.
The only question is, Does he keep to them and does he use them?
No.
That's all.
No,
okay, go ahead.
Yes, that is what we said.
But, most excellent men, how shall we define this participation which you attribute to both? Is it not that of which we were just speaking?
What is that?
A passive or active condition arising out of some power, which is derived from a combination of elements. Possibly, Theaetetus, you do not hear their reply to this, but I hear it, perhaps because I am used to them.
What is it then that they say?
They do not concede to us what we said just now to the aboriginal giants about being.
What was it?
We set up as a satisfactory sort of definition of being the presence of the power to act or be acted upon in even the slightest degree.
Yes.
It is in reply to this that they say generation participates in the power of acting and of being acted upon, but that neither power is connected with being.
And is there not something in that?
Yes, something to which we must reply that we still need to learn more clearly from them, whether they agree that the soul knows and that being is known.
You see it.
Yes, you see
they
it.
Certainly assent to this. They certainly assent to that.
Well then, do you say that knowing or being known is an active or passive condition, or both? Or that one is passive and the other active? Or that neither has any share at all in either of the two?
Clearly they would say that neither has any share in either, for otherwise they would be contradicting themselves.
I understand. This at least is true, that if to know is active, to be known must in turn be passive. Now, being, since it is, according to this theory, known by the intelligence, insofar as it is known, is moved, since it is acted upon, which we say cannot be the case with that which is in a state of rest.
Is that true?
No.
Come on, there it is. He now comes to his first conclusion. Insofar as it is known, it is moved, since it's been acted upon. And certainly that can't take place if something is at rest. Is that true? Yes or no? If you know, on choice, if you know being, uh-huh. It is changed. That's what he's saying, isn't it?
It is changed?
Yeah. Because it's moved.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. So being is moved when it's got, when it's known.
That's a big problem.
That is a big problem, isn't it?
Yeah, because it needs to stay the same.
Yeah, wouldn't remain the same.
Yeah.
So his definition of being is shot once again. So he has good answers, but he may not know what to do with them.
Yep.
One, two more. Okay, come on.
Right.
But for heaven's sake, shall we let ourselves easily be persuaded that motion and life and soul and mind are really not present to absolute being? That it neither lives nor thinks, but awful and wholly devoid of mind, is fixed and immovable?
That would be a shocking admission to make, stranger.
But shall we say that it has mind but not life?
How can we?
But do we say that both of these exist in it, and yet go on to say that it does not possess them in a soul?
But how else can it possess them?
Then shall we say that it has mind and life and soul, but although endowed with soul, is absolutely immovable?
All these things seem to me absurd.
And it must be conceded that motion and that which is moved exist.
Of course.
Then the result is, Theaetetus, that if there is no motion, there is no mind in anyone about anything, anywhere.
Exactly.
And on the other hand, if we admit that all things are in flux and motion, we shall remove mind itself from the number of existing things by this theory also.
How so?
Do you think that sameness of quality or nature or relations could ever come into existence without the state of rest?
Not at all.
What then? Without these, can you see how mind could exist or come into existence anywhere?
By no means.
And yet we certainly must contend by every argument against him who does away with knowledge or reason or mind, and then makes any dogmatic assertion about anything.
Certainly.
Then the philosopher, who pays the highest honor to these things, must necessarily, as it seems, because of them, refuse to accept the theory of those who say that the universe is at rest, whether as a unity or in many forms, and must also refuse utterly to listen to those who say that being is universal motion. He must quote the children's prayer, all things immovable and in motion, and must say that being and the universe consist of both.
Very true.
Okay, what do you think? There we are. Come on, first statement. Then the philosopher who pays the highest honor to these things must necessarily, as it seems, because of them, refuse to accept the theory of those who say the universe is at rest, whether as a unity or in many forms, and must also refuse utterly to listen to those who say that being is universal motion. He must quote the children's prayer, all things immovable and in motion. I must say that being and the universe consist of both.
Very true.
So it's both at rest and in motion.
Being.
And we can't say
that's being.
That, or the all.
Yeah, and they're all. That because it's everything. All things are movable and in motion. We must say that being and the universe consist of both.
Being. So then those two are not separate levels then?
Well, worse than that. Look. And he must also refuse utterly to listen to those who say that being is universal motion. He must quote the child's prayer. Hey, everything is immovable and in motion. So take a look. It's a very great statement, all right? Who's the philosopher? He refuses to accept the theory of those who say the universe is at rest. That's good. The universe is not at rest. Whether as a unity or in many forms. See, in the first place, if they say the universe, he refuses to accept the idea the universe is at rest. Watch. Whether as a unity or as many forms. Now, if he's talking about the forms, what is he talking about?
If
the realm of being, not the universe.
That's right. That's right.
But in this terms of the argument, would it be like mind, life, soul? Reason.
Well, I mean, it's where do you see he's made that connection? Like,
no, not that it was an explicit connection, but because he repeated those in the preceding passages a number of times, I was wondering if he was offering that as a replacement for them.
Would you agree the conclusion is we must say that being and the universe consist of both?
Yes.
What are the two? Motion and rest.
Yes.
That is not true.
Because it only consists of
it's one or the other. This is at rest. No possibility of motion, always is. So he has both the universe and being. With the immovable and in motion. Does it make any sense? What grade would you give him so far?
I think you'd make a good salad.
Okay. We quit? Okay, this is where we go back. So what do you make of this work so far?
It's the
best thing you can say about it, as if you were to film this, all of the people sitting around would be jabbing one another, laughing at every remark. It's a satire. It's got to be a satire, or it's impossible. This is a philosophical satire. Literally, everything is absurd. Mm-hmm. And he's making it appear as if it makes sense, as best he can. It's a satirical.
Mm-hmm. But what's the point of doing
it? Now, why is he doing it?
Yeah.
That's the issue. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And why do the Neoplatonists take it seriously?
Righto. Now you got my question. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. I would have sung a million times. What was the last?
Is it there?
Like,
very strange, isn't it?